did you guys like the film?
Yes.
It's a terrible subject, but it's a really wonderful educational film on what's happened to Lyme disease in the United States and all around the world. But what you see is some challenges for patients. But I wanted to talk about staying in the solution as we move forward. And staying in the solution is finding gratitude for all the positives that has happened since all of this. And there's a lot of them. And every time I speak, I ask for people to raise their hands, and I'm gonna do that tonight, because you're gonna see the word is not getting out about the positives. So that's my job. So the positives are what are gonna propel us through treatment and forward to pass the word on. So what are they? The positives are that we now have 11 new ICD codes for Lyme disease. Most all of them are on disseminated Lyme disease, otherwise known as chronic. So that's a really wonderful thing when patients go into their doctor's office and they come up with these symptoms and the doctors start typing in, well, this is how mine does it. I don't know how Amy or Ginger does it, but the symptoms, and you know, they go through what it could be, and the CPT codes will start popping up now. This was as of January 22, okay? So really wonderful, we now have 15 ICD codes for Lyme disease where we had 4 for 50 years. So the other thing that's wonderful, bad for some people, great for us, there was a case that you guys may not know about, that 7 major insurance companies settled out of court last year in Texarkana. Raise your hand if you know about this. One person, okay? Mm-hmm. So it's Tory versus IDSA. It was not a successful case in the fact that IDSA was not held accountable, unfortunately, but the really great thing was these 7 major insurance companies settled out of court. They have oodles of money, and innocent people don't settle out of court. They fight like hell. They did not do that. So we have some really great things that have been happening since then, where patients are suing doctors. Terrible for the doctors, but for misdiagnosing them for years and years and years. It's great. I wrote down Ira Moore. He's a Lyme attorney that's, I don't know if he's still around and working in this community, but there are people like him that keep us going. And y'all need to know about these things because these are solutions. What else did I write down? I wanted to thank the researchers like Neil Spector, Monica Embers. There's so many, Brian Fallon, and my very new favorite research is In Cell DX is Dr. Bruce Patterson, and that's the lab work that y'all see, my paper that's floating around. That's really important that you guys get connected with that. I would love it if you guys all go to my YouTube channel, just type my name. And his presentation is the very first one that pops up. It'll just start playing. And it's on chronic inflammation. He has coined chronic Lyme disease. He was talking about it as PTLDS. Brilliant man, researches behind him, and us validating chronic Lyme disease. He's coined it long Lyme. Why? So many people died of long COVID, but it got the attention. Hey, symptoms persist. Okay, What he's done is really brilliant. He has come up with two diagnostic tools now for persistent Lyme disease. Go to my website and let's see here. This one here, I asked you guys to get it. This is my website down here. And you can review all of this stuff and learn about it, okay? The important thing is he treats children with this stuff. The rocktail is an old drug, repurposed. Maraviroc sells entries Maraviroc, Lipitor, baby aspirin for some people, and colchicine, a gout drug. I'm not recommending you guys take this medicine, okay? I'm recommending everybody go listen to that the presentation. I hosted a Lyme disease awareness event last year in May in Richardson. I sold out two theaters with tickets, and I said big brains deserve big screens, because it was, I mean, it was Alamo, huge theater, and his head was like giant. It was awesome. I loved it. It was so much fun. But he presented his slideshow on all of this stuff, and he literally said millions of people are walking around with chronic inflammation at risk of microclotting, because he's discovered that Lyme disease and COVID are actually endothelial diseases. Everybody here has vasculitis, more than likely. I certainly did, and so did three of my children. That means we could be playing ball one day or exercising like all our doctors tell us to do. He says do not. We're at risk for stroke, aneurysm, thrombosis, heart attack, because of chronic inflammation. So everybody that's ever had these diseases needs to be checked. That's millions and millions of people, everybody in this room. And then you'll know, you know, if you need to do it or not, the rocktail. So talk to your doctor, go to his website, covidlonghaulers.com, order the test. It's $1,000. You know the drill. You pay cash and then you file for reimbursement. But the important thing is he's on our side. He's brilliant. He's got CPT codes for every single one of the markers now, and he's saying that even Medicare should be, I'm not saying everybody will, because I don't know, get 100% reimbursed from your insurance company, 100%. So I don't know, I have a pile of reimbursement, you know, things in my desk that's that thick. So this one is Congress. This one is what I wanted to move to real fast, is legislation starts today. The main thing that I hear every time that I try to get a champion to take a bill for Lyme patients and to protect doctors to the floor, we're not hearing this is a problem. It's this very top sentence. Y'all need to read that. We're not hearing this is a problem from our constituents. Where are y'all? We need to call. We need to email every single one of us, please. This will be the last year for me to try to push a bill. I'm tired. I'm not going to do it anymore by myself. Everybody's going to step up, and I know you guys will, because I'm driving all over Texas last year and this year to make this happen, okay? So I'm counting on you guys. What? Write them a letter. This scan up here is write them your brief story. And you're going to find your representative. Sorry, skip number one. Number two, what? Tell them your brief story. Here, they've wrote a letter for you. I always tell people, make it personal. Put a little paragraph, a small one. Don't write everything, because we've got, you know, decades of a story to tell. And then where and when? Give them your address and start today. So that's important. So please scan this one and make that happen. Let your representatives know. I don't care if you're independent, Republican, or Democrat. I'm a delegate for the state of Texas, and I need you guys to be one too. Show up. You don't have to go to all these places. All this stuff is virtual. it can happen from your bed in your jammies with your hair, you know, going kooky. Nobody cares. Nobody sees you. All right, what else? This one is 100% virtual. Center for Lyme Action is amazing. Bonnie Crater and her brother, the Lyme lobbyist, Jeff Crater, started it, co-founders. And all they do, 100% of their work, is to lobby for raising federal funding for Lyme disease. That's all they do. Now, scan that one to find out more about signing up for their virtual Lyme fly-ins. We just had one in February. I'm the Texas state lead, so you'll be on my team. We always have lots of fun. But I show you exactly how to do it, and they've made it already very cookie cutter because they know their Jeff Crater's kiddos, which are Bonnie Crater's niece and nephew, have Lyme. And they're doing well, but as you guys know, I'm great today, and I was great last year, and I was doing okay the year before that. But 10 years from now, I do this work because I may need treatment. My kids may need treatment. So we've got to make Lyme doctors a thing every single place that people might get bit by ticks. Okay? So my email is down here. If you guys have any questions about any of this stuff, please, please, please. It's so easy. Now, Center for Lyme Action, I got a really fancy bag the first year. The second, third, and fourth year, Center for Lyme Action scarf. So that when we go to these virtual Zoom meetings, we all are representing Center for Lyme Action and we look alike. So it's kind of like a uniform kind of thing. It's very cool. But I'm gonna let you guys pass this around so that you see. But look how fancy. They're so dang professional. You guys need to know Bonnie Crater and Jeff Crater. They're amazing people. But super easy, yeah, you see my highlights and my pen markings, and but the thing of it is, they lay it out really clearly for people to get it. Lyme is increasing, federal funding is almost non-existent for Lyme. So we're comparing malaria, I had my glasses and now they're gone, $150,000 per patient for malaria. West Nile, $6,870. Lyme patients. I have my glasses. I think it's $82. It's either a six or an eight. So this is the problem. When you meet with a legislator, with Center for Lyme Action, they get these in their email and they can see it. And then they have a presentation that I show and I page through and speak on these things and point it out. So here's the report of when they started in 2019 and then down with successes. $405 million, you guys. The goal is not to feed the bad actors because it's a waste of time. Show up, guys. This stuff works. It works. People are listening and we're successful as heck. So the point is, attract new researchers to vector-borne illness. That's the goal. We know some of that money is going to go to the Wormsers of the world. Let them. There's plenty now to go around and we're going to keep attracting. Also, one of the things I made a note of is I was invited by the Center for Lyme Action to go to the congressional series that is being hosted in DC on the 3rd, and it is wonderful because it is on Lyme disease and military readiness. We need to protect people who are protecting us. Is that not the craziest thing? These people are being sent home from active duty. One was one of the original female Thunderbird fighter pilots taken out by Lyme disease. Now she advocates for Lyme disease. Another one serves on my board, Anders Carlson, and he's coming with me, and he was appointed in Texas, so he helps advocate in Texas with me. He now lives in Oklahoma, but nonetheless, these people are showing up for you. It's so wonderful, you guys. These are all successes. So I just want you guys to know what is happening. I'm going to pass this around so that you guys can see how professional these people have put so much time and effort into this. And just briefly, I'm going to stop talking about this after I mention this, but the very first thing is to fully fund the Kay Hagan Tick Act, $30 million, that's all. It was signed into law in 2019. We've worked last year and this year to fund it, okay? Kay Hagan passed away from the Powassan virus. She was a legislator, okay? Republicans get bit by ticks, Democrats get bit, Independents get bit. Who's showing up? That's what I care about. Number two, fund HHS Lyme X Innovation Accelerator, $5 million. Three, fund Lyme and tick-borne disease prevention programs, only $30 million. Number four is fund NIH, NIA, Lyme and tick-borne disease and conditions research, $135 million. Number five, our ask was to fund peer-reviewed tick-borne disease research, $9 million. So you guys can see all my chicken scratch. But pass this around so that you guys see all the good stuff that is happening on your behalf and our doctors. And then I wanted to honor the doctors before it gets too late. Ginger, do not leave. I wanted to give these out and honor them to let them know how much we appreciate them, because they have been sticking their necks out for us for so long and taking it under the chin. And they spend so much time with patients, and I promise you, you think that they're making zillions of boat payments? I'm working with somebody to potentially open a Lyme clinic. It ain't like that. It's not like that. The insurance and all the costs and staff is astounding. They could tell you more about it. But thank you so much, you guys. Ginger, Amy, and the biodentist, I'm so sorry, I don't know your name, but I wanted to honor you too, because she sees a lot of Lyme patients. And one of the craziest things about Lyme disease is the mouth is so highly infected. I've had to have cavitation surgery twice. It's extremely common. If you've had it once, you may need it again.
Yes, Dr. Elizabeth Ray.
Thank you so much. Your microphone's not on. Charlie, can you turn her microphone on for me? So, do you guys mind coming up here? I have a little special gift for you guys. And Kelly has the microphone. If you could give it to whomever wants to go first, but we'd love to hear a little bit about just brief. Thank you so much for everything that you guys do for us.
Thank you.
And I just wanted to say that Amy was my kid's first doctor. It was a little far, but watch yourself.
Oh, here you go.
Now, this bag has a personalized signed book by Fred Diamond, who wrote Love, gosh, am I saying it right? I always get it backwards. Let me look. Yeah, I got it right. Love, Hope, Lyme, Fred Diamond. This is a great book to buy. I have a couple out there. They're $20. It's a donation from him. So your money goes to our nonprofit. But he's amazing. He doesn't even have Lyme. So I just wanted to pass these to you guys to say thank you very much for all you guys do.
Thank you. I'll just say really quickly, thank you, Kristina, for all of your hard work. So many people appreciate it. I hear your name come up a lot. For those of you I don't know, my name is Amy Offit. I am a doctor out in Marble Falls, and I have the privilege of serving as the current ILAS president. And so I loved watching that film, because I recognize a lot of the heroes in that film, and like the pioneering doctors who have gone ahead of me and so many others who've been strong and courageous even when there was a huge resistance to their work and their ideas. And so I'm so grateful, and Ginger is one of those people as well. I do want to say I know Bonnie Crater, and there is a really good video that's on the Center for Lyme Action website that was a webinar that they did for ILADS, and a collaborative webinar that's really good, and it's not very long, that reviews everything beautifully with Nicole Bell, who's from Galaxy Labs, and then Bonnie's on there as well. If you guys are interested in a deeper dive, like, that's a really good thing to watch. And then I'm also glad to say that ILADS does have a Neil Spector Award honoring Dr. Spector and his work, and it's really a privilege every year to be able to remind everyone of him, his work, his legacy, his courage, as you saw. And just being a part of ILADS has been such a privilege for me. And so I'm just an hour away. Like Kristina said, I might see like 5 patients a day because they're complicated. I spend most of my time seeing patients, and then some of the other time trying to work in the same areas that all of you are here because of. So thank you for doing this, and I'll pass this over to the teachers.
Thank you. I do not practice in Texas anymore. Some of you may know I sort of got kicked out of the state, more or less. And so ran into a lot of troubles here with the board over what I was doing. I started treating Lyme here 24 years ago. And so let's see, I had to start practicing elsewhere in 2007. And I first went to California, and then now I'm in Washington, D.C. But I still have a lot of Texas patients that come to see me. Everybody in this film I know very well. They're all friends of mine, all of the different doctors and people who spoke on this have been involved with ILADS a long time. I've given probably 5 different talks at ILADS over the years, and written a lot of articles on the topic and all of that, spoken all over the U.S. I'm slowing down though, getting older, and I just don't do quite as much of that stuff as I used to. But I'm still seeing patients, I'm still involved in that, although I'm not, like Amy said, you know, these patients take a long time, so I really don't see that many in a day. And it's actually very exhausting work too, so it's hard to do it on a very full-time basis. But anyway, I want to thank you, Kristina, because you're obviously doing great work here. I think all this came about since I left, but anyway, you are quite a cheerleader for the cause, so really appreciate that. Thank you.
You're a trailblazer.
Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Elizabeth Rain, and I practice biological dentistry in South Austin. And one of the big things that I'm seeing now is an increase of patients that have health history of Lyme. And a lot of the patients don't realize they have chronic inflammation going on unless they've been diagnosed. I've had patients come in that have inflammation, and when I teach them that they possibly may have Lyme, and I try to refer them to patients so that they can find out the answers. But they need to have heavy metals testing done, and they need to have inflammation testing done. And we offer that to patients, some of the different testing, but importantly, when we take out the heavy metals in their mouth, we do it safely, and I'm certified to do that. You have to be very cautious with it so that they don't reabsorb their metals. And then you have to educate them about the different ideas of placing dental products in their body. Some of the products they're very much allergic to, or they'll have reactions to it. A lot of people aren't aware of that. They have different blood tests that they can take to help educate them about their products that they're utilizing. The other thing that I've noticed is some people do remove teeth, and there's reasons for removing teeth. If you have root canals, a lot of patients don't want to believe that the root canals are harming them, but the root canals really store a lot of the bacteria, the fungus, the virus, the toxins, They're within the ligaments, they're within the bone structure, they're within the tooth structure. And when you start removing teeth that are very much infected, you'll see differences in their health. But their immune systems can only do so much. And so we have to help the immune system as we're helping them with their teeth. And many, many, many dentists in this town don't agree with it. I've been harassed by many dentists because they think I'm in the woo-woo land of dentistry. But I've seen people change. I've seen their health improve. Cavitation surgeries are biggies. There's different avenues to address cavitation surgery. And a cavitation meaning there are areas in the bone that will become infected, and they may be infected from prior extractions that could have happened years ago when the person was in high school. And many, many, many dentists don't believe in that either. So I've seen a lot of resistance with a biological movement. And there are a few people in Austin that do it, but there are only a few people who've been certified to do it. I can applaud the people who are trying to do it. I think it's great that they're learning. But the most important thing is once you start learning about your health, starting in the mouth, it really is an eye-opener, and some people aren't ready for it. Financially, they're not ready for it, or mentally, they're not ready for it. Physically, they may be ready for it, but they have to put all of these different avenues together so that they can really benefit for their body. So, but if you have questions, you can contact me. I don't mind having a conversation. I think it's really important to be educated. That's the most critical thing. Then you can make choices for your body, for your needs, for your future, and do it when it's appropriate for you. But I'm offering time for people, and I don't charge to talk to someone. If they want to have a conversation with me on the phone, even in the later day, I don't mind. On the weekends, I don't mind. Personally, I don't mind. There are other people out there that have told me how much they mind, but I'm available if somebody has any questions. If I can help you, I will.
What's your website?
info@naturaltoothfairy.com.
Is your email address?
Email.
You said info at, that's an email.
Oh, that's right, that's correct. But naturaltoothfairy.com, and we have info, and then we have raindds@yahoo.com. But we have different sites now. I don't know what they like to, where they like to receive the information. So
yeah, okay. So your website,
it may be naturaltoothfairy.com.
So it's a great, no, it's okay. So it's great to work.
Yes, in naturaltoothfairy.com.
Your name is?
My name is Margaret Elizabeth Rain, and I've been a dentist for about 40 years. I've done this type of work since 2000. I started this because a patient friend of mine came to me and said his girlfriend was very, very ill. So I made the decision to step out of the box of standard of care dentistry, and I cannot go back. I'm learning and learning and learning. I'm studying to be a naturopath on the side, so I can't go backwards. I have to keep going forwards with this information.
Hey. Yeah, when you know, you know.
Yes.
Big round of applause. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You're so welcome. All the work you guys are doing for patients. Here, take this for Kelly, would you? Be careful, guys. Thank you. Okay. So, lastly, you guys, I know it's getting late. I wanted to talk just briefly about congenital Lyme. So many people are not aware that Lyme disease definitely is passed, any kind of pathogens are passed transplacentally. So everybody who has Lyme disease, their children need, you're gonna go around, Amy, come back down. There you go. I know it's tricky. It's tricky chairs. Thank you for coming. Those of you guys that are leaving, love you so much. If you took videos or anything, please post and tag us. But we're glad that you guys came. Real brief, the round table on the right has some congenital Lyme, the white paper that Dr. Wilson wrote for the ACOG conference I was telling you about before the movie. And what I found, or what I put on my website about it, but everybody needs to know this, and Lyme disease can be a just generational illness. A lot of times these doctors are taking thorough health histories, and all good Lyme doctors always ask about the maternal health and did you play in the woods, that kind of stuff. Does anybody have questions about anything? Kelly's got a microphone if you guys would like to ask anything. It's kind of small in here, so we probably don't need it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd love to hear if you guys have anything. Yeah. Can you take the microphone just so the recording will pick up?
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, that's better.
Okay, I'm not sure if this is the type of question that you would want right now, but I'm curious if anyone has had experience using ivermectin for Lyme treatment.
Definitely did when I was doing pharmaceutical medicine for parasites. And Babesia is of course a parasite, so a lot of times Lyme doctors will throw that in with other allopathic medicine. No, it's not a Lyme.
So it's just like for dealing with the whole conundrum.
It's a parasite drug, so it's good for Babesia and parasites, but it does not treat Lyme or Bartonella or mold or any of the other things that go with Lyme. But I'm not a doctor, so talk to your doctor about it.
I was going to share one other quick thing about the I just wanted to say thank you so much for the work you're doing, and that was really wonderful to see. It feels like it's been a long time coming that like there just needs to be more information and just more gatherings like this, and I feel like we've all been kind of like doing our work, like, and it's hard, but whenever I see that, I'm like, okay, stuff is being done, we need to do more. And it was really, the whole thing was really emotional, but seeing Dr. Spector really hit me really hard, because early on in my Lyme journey, I remember just like the confusion around getting a diagnosis, and then my parents haven't really been the greatest. I think it's just so hard sometimes, like, to be, no one's perfect, and they just like don't know what to do sometimes, you know, and but my mom at one point did, like, the one time that she seemed to like take it more upon herself to get a little more involved and like really doing like Googling and researching, she had seen a piece on Dr. Spector years ago about his heart transplant, and she like called him and just thought like maybe I can get a hold of him, and he strangely enough like took the time out to, I think we wrote him an email or something, but he like took the time out to contact me, and I wasn't a patient of his, he was just doing research, but
okay, that's not strange for him,
and it was just like it really like touched my heart a lot. He took a lot of time to just have a personal one-on-one conversation with me just about his journey and about like how hard it is, and he knew, and I just wanted to share with you all like that is really how he is, and he even told me that the person he must have gotten the heart from must have been a really sentimental person, because ever since that he would like cry more and he like chocolate now than he did it before, and it was really sweet.
He was a sweet man.
Yeah, so I just wanted to like
send
the love out to him, and also just if anybody has any information specifically on like the research that he was showing, is that actually going to happen?
We funded it. Yeah, no, we funded it last year. It wasn't a ton of money, but I got a thank you note from his wife, Denise. The same day I got a donation from Dr. Ken Wigner. He donates every year. These people are amazing. The same day I was like, wow, this work is so rewarding sometimes. So his work is amazing, and you should also know that I, a couple months ago, might have even been last year. No, it was the beginning of this year. So Dr. Tim Haystead at Duke University took over his work on behalf of Neil Spector to carry it forward. So Bay Area Lyme Foundation, of course, donated a ton of money again to his work to carry it forward, but it is a diagnostic and a treatment, and it's based off of oncology tumor targeting therapy. So what he described, they're actually doing. So he's gonna be so proud in heaven up there, like looking down at all these patients like, your promise did come true. And it is coming true. It's still being funded now to make sure that the research is completed and that it comes to market, because there's so many things that sound so great. The Lyme doctors don't get excited about things anymore because of that. But this is one thing that is definitely superior. And I fully expect that we'll continue to fundraise for his work. That's the only work that I'm fundraising for. And 100% of donations for research goes to his research. I don't donate to anybody else. Also, I wanted to thank Dr. Jayakumar Rajadas and Pope Nini. They were at the early work of Stanford's original focus on finding out which FDA-approved drugs off-label killed Lyme disease in test tube, and he was the founder that disulfiram killed Lyme disease in a test tube. I don't recommend disulfiram anymore right now because it's very difficult. A lot of people got better, but a lot of people got hurt too. So we just want to be careful when these things aren't FDA regulated, or, you know, a lot of our medication and stuff is off label, so that doesn't scare me. But I run one of the largest disulfiram for Lyme Facebook groups, and I've seen a lot of stuff. And I worked underneath a pharmacist of 22 years at the State of California Mental Hospital. So she dosed that drug for alcoholism when 50 years ago when it came out, that's what it was used for mainly. Originally, it was for latex, people in a latex manufacturing place were getting sick. So it's been used for a lot of different things. So as you guys know, we are always gonna be looking for the next new and better things, but I've always only started my nonprofit to fundraise for treatments because I felt like Bay Area Lyme and the Cohens, thank God for the Cohens. There's so many really great foundations out there that are fundraising for treatment, diagnostic tools, that I wanted to focus on research for treatments, and that's a big one for us.
Do you think right now is a good time to talk about, so we're looking at starting an Austin Lyme disease support group again. There was one here for a really long time, and you and I just briefly talked about, low-dose immunotherapy. And I am kind of known around the globe as the LDI for short. And so I wanted to make that the first meeting. We don't have a date or anything, but you have been for everybody's information, right? And so we're going to start scheduling a meeting. That's what changed my son's life after years. Even Dr. Offit, she was kind of on the cusp at the very beginning of becoming Lyme literate. And she said, Kelly, I can't help him. He's too complicated for me. He was serious, okay?
Yeah.
And it has been amazing. It's a blend between homeopathy and allergy tolerance medication that was developed and pioneered by Dr. Ty Benson. And it's a drop under your tongue every 7 weeks.
Well, he wasn't the original.
He pioneered the antigens, correct.
Not originally. They're the traitor. There was two in the U.S.
To be clear,
yeah.
I'm sure what you're talking about.
Thank you.
Trust me on this. Traeger had taken the EPA and taken it into
LDA,
which is the inhalant allergy.
Yes, right.
And foods. Ty Benson pioneered LDI, okay, for infectious pathogen diseases. So anyway, I look forward to talking more about that. I've helped a lot of families to recovery, and it's not as hard. It's
because you
become autoimmune to these pathogens where
no amount
of antibiotics or anything can help killing therapies.
Yep, thank you. She has a question behind you. We used LDI also along with homeopathics, herbs, and that kind of thing, and it really does boost quite a bit, so it's very helpful.
So is one of the reasons that Lyme is so controversial because of its origins, which were not discussed in this in this documentary about maybe it would be?
What do you mean about its origins, as far as where it was found, or, sorry?
Yeah, the fact that, you know, it's the product of, I don't know, gain-of-function research or something else that's been hushed up.
Oh, you're talking about bioweapon? Is that what she's talking about? Yeah. So, okay, so I interviewed Chris Newby. So her book is amazing. I listened to it twice in one day. It's a really good book. Her book is Bitten, and it's amazing. I have over 50 expert interviews on my YouTube channel where I've only sought to speak to people who are making a big impact, usually just researchers and clinicians to discuss treatments. And what she has done is gotten government documents proving that bioweapon research was being conducted, etc. But there's no clear cut information that proves that the origin or the explosion of Lyme disease came from bioweapon research. We do know that they were conducting research on it, infecting ticks with diseases and threw boxes of them out over Cuba. Lots of awful things came out of this, but if you are very interested in that, you'll want to get her book, listen to it, read it. She goes into great detail on the bioweapons research.
She interviewed
Willie Bergdorfer. Yeah. Yeah, she knew him personally, went to his garage, he gave her all of his documents. Like, this stuff has been documented. So here's the thing, it sends stress straight through my body to talk about this stuff, and here's why. There's no solution in getting pissed off, going down those rabbit holes. Go for it. If you guys are interested in that, go for it. I want to stay in the solution. I want to help patients get better. I sure hope Truth Cures and all these other places beat the heck out of these people. Go for it if they deserve it. But that didn't help anybody get better. I want people to get better out of the trenches. That's my whole goal. So it's a very valid question, and she writes all about that, but there's no clear-cut science stating that Lyme disease came from bioweapon research or exploded from. But look at the maps, look at all the stuff. She's done all the research that's ever been done on it. She did the majority of exposing all of it. It's really good. But her book is Bitten. Like I said, her interview's on my website and talks a lot about all this stuff. Okay, thank you.
Extremely knowing about bioweapons research and gain of function research, because, you know, look where COVID came from, and that's not going to be the last.
Yeah, we don't want it to happen again.
Yeah, I mean,
that's why this is not just like staying the solution, but it's gonna happen again. It's not when, it's gonna happen again, and it's gonna keep on happening. And you guys are like the origin, the first of it, kind of, possibly, right? It's a canary, and so we want this to stop.
So yeah, for sure. Exactly, and it's just another reason to contact your legislator.
Yeah.
So. It's important.
There was like a few years ago, I heard there was actually articles about this congressman that had formally made a move to declassify information.
Chris Smith. New Jersey. Yeah. So he's really amazing, but it didn't go anywhere. He's Chuck Schumer had Lyme disease. Lots of legislators are very aware and working hard. And that's another positive to really remind yourselves that there's a lot of people who fully understand what's going on, and they're working on our behalf and working hard. So we have 10 minutes left that we need to clear out our tables and stuff. So do you guys have any other questions? Yeah.
Is there any evidence or research done using a condom diet or
A what? Sorry?
Has there been any research for using the carnivore diet to starve toe infections with Lyme? It's just a thought. I'm just wondering if you've heard.
Are you referring to the carnivore diet?
Just lowering sugars.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure we were talking about the same thing.
Yeah.
So I'm not aware of research on the carnivore diet, but I am more familiar with research on alpha-gal, which is maybe a little twist.
Okay.
I prefer the blood type diet, okay? My body doesn't like meat. I don't feel good when I eat beef. Beef is hands down the absolute hardest on your body to digest. It takes hours and hours and hours, and then it ferments, and then you've got issues. So I'm not saying it's a bad diet, but for the blood type that I am, I'm a pescatarian pretty much daily. So I think that's valid, is to read the research and look up blood type diets. What works better for you may be the carnivore diet. What works better for me, that would not be a good diet for me. But across the board, low inflammation, low histamine diet for Lyme patients, and then you take it where your blood type diet makes sense to me.
What about the concept of just low sugar, low carb?
You cannot. Yeah, absolutely. Sorry, I missed that part. Absolutely. Yeah. So we know that Borrelia and parasites in particular feed off of sugar. So yeah, that's Lyme patients know that when they eat sugar or high carb diet, they don't feel good.
Exactly.
Yeah. So it's an inflammatory diet, not an anti-inflammatory diet, is to eat all the sugar.
That's good to know and validated, so good to hear.
I'm just a health coach, I'm just a mom, but I think those are very valid. I do read a lot, but I'm no doctor, so always talk to your doctor, do the research on that stuff. Anybody else? Okay, so what do you guys want us to work on, right? Like, we're here for you. So Kelly and I were talking about it. We're both big fans of low-dose immunotherapy. So we thought next meeting, I for sure don't want to spend my time complaining about stuff. I started this meeting off with staying in the solutions, and I'm going to finish there. So that's a solution. And Kelly and I did it, I think it was 3 years ago even. It's been a while.
The podcast.
Yeah. So where we discussed low-dose immunotherapy, and it's really helpful. There is a lot to be said about frequency medicine, frequency testing. It's absolutely what got us into remission. We still do it. We still test, backed it all up with science, like I started the meeting off with. So I applied integrative, then allopathy, because no one can push me down. I'm CDC positive, I'm Igenix positive. I did the research. I did the allopathic way. It didn't work for me. It may for you or anybody else, but I did the integrative and then followed it with the blood work and stuff to prove what the frequency testing was showing was spot on. It's 95% accurate and it's cheap as heck. So we can talk about that another time. Sorry.
You said frequency testing. Can you clarify a little bit?
Electrodermal screening, but the practitioner matters and the system matters. You can't just
or autotomic response testing that Dr. Kling
go anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So you guys, thank you so much for coming and supporting the event and sharing the event with people. And you guys are brave. All of your treatments and talking about this with other people and getting out there is really wonderful what everybody's putting forth. So thank you for coming, you guys. Appreciate it. Thank you. You're so welcome. My pleasure.